Well, we're in the second chapter of Paul's letter to Pastor Titus, okay? So Titus chapter 2, and our text is verse 11 down through verse 15. We looked 2 weeks ago at verse 11. This morning we're going to be focused in on just verse 12. So we'll just be looking at Titus chapter 2, verse 12. I'll read verse 11 and verse 12, but I'll stop reading at the end of verse 12 this morning. And what a tremendous text in dealing with the grace of God. The title of my message, which is actually a series from this portion of Scripture, is Grace, Grace, Grace. I tell you, I am amazed at the grace of God. Aren't you amazed at the grace of God? Newton put it well when he said, amazing grace, how sweet the sound. Oh, the marvelous grace of God. The magnificent grace of God. How grateful I am this morning for the grace of God. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible says in verse 11, for the grace of God has appeared with salvation for all people. That does not mean that all people are saved. It just means that the grace of God is available to all the peoples of this world. The grace of God is available. And when we read over the book of Revelation about what John sees about the people before God, those who have been redeemed, they are out of every nation, every tribe, every language, right? And so the grace of God is available to Jew and Gentile, to all the peoples of the earth. The grace of God has appeared with salvation for all people. Now, we're going to really get focused in on verse 12 this morning, instructing us to deny godlessness and worldly lust and to live in a sensible, righteous, and godly way in this present age. And so the grace of God, grace, the biblical term, charis, is the word that's translated grace. And that word, those of you who are writing notes, I see some people writing some things down. You would transliterate that if you want to write down that word for grace. C-H-A-R-I-S, okay, is how we would use it with our alphabet. Charis. Charis. Grace, that word means in the biblical context and outside the Bible, extra-biblical context, that word simply means undeserved blessing. Okay? Unearned blessing. Undeserved blessing. Undeserved favor. And that's the way it's used in Scripture and out of Scripture, that Greek term. But now we're concerned with the biblical context and the biblical usage of that word charis. And so undeserved blessing, when we talk about the grace of God, we're talking about the undeserved, unearned, unmerited blessings of the Lord. And are any blessings from God earned by us? No, they're not. We don't deserve the blessings of God. We do not work for the blessings of God. The grace of God comes forth from the motivation of God's heart. God is full of mercy and God is full of grace. And we receive God motivated not in the recipient, but motivated by the giver. God is the giver of grace. Now, in verse 11, we saw a couple of weeks ago that he talks about the appearance of grace. My point was the revelation of grace. And he speaks about this as something that has happened in the past, okay? The grace of God has appeared. The grace of the Lord has shown up. It has appeared. And what is no doubt being referred to is the grace of God coming in this world packaged in the person of the Lord Jesus. And particularly the grace of God as to be demonstrated in the atoning work of Christ for our sin. Christ's saving work on the cross. The grace of God that brings salvation. And that is through the Lord Jesus Christ. The grace of God that saves souls. That grace has appeared. And so in a moment of history, in a time in history, the grace of God has appeared. But now, and please stay with me in this, The grace of God that Paul was writing about in verse 11, as he continues to expound upon it in verses 12 and following, he's talking about the continual operation of that grace of God that has shown up, that has appeared. And he begins talking about the grace of God in its present tense operation. And so the grace of God is not just something that we have seen in the past and that we benefit from the past in Christ dying on the cross. That is the greatest of all of the expositions of the grace of God. Christ in his work for us at Calvary and becoming our Savior, dying for our sins on the cross. That is the greatest of all the expressions of the grace of God. But when I talk about the grace of God as Paul is talking about it here in Titus chapter 2, he's talking about the continual experience of the grace of God. Because he says it has appeared, and now here's what it does. Here's what the grace of God does. This grace that has appeared in Jesus, that has given us forgiveness of sin, has guaranteed us a future with God in heaven. Here's what it does in the here and now. And to give you my sermon in a nutshell, is this: the grace of God gives us a saved life. The grace of God has not only provided me forgiveness and reconciliation with God and a home in heaven, but the grace of God has granted to me a saved life. I can live a saved life because of the grace of God. My life can demonstrate the saving power of Jesus on a day-by-day basis, and it should demonstrate the saving power of Jesus day by day. God did not just save me with a past connection with salvation in which my sins are forgiven and the account and record of my transgressions against God is settled. And God has not only saved me in the fact that when life is over for me here in this world, I'm going to go to heaven. Listen, between my conversion experience and my last breath here in this world, I've got a saved life to live. The grace of God has given us a saved life. The grace of God, this morning we see, instructs us in this saved way of living. And so we're looking at the instruction of grace. We've seen the revelation of grace in Jesus in verse 11. And now we see what the grace of God is doing in the lives of those who have received that grace. What does the grace of God do? Well, it instructs us. Verse 12, instructing us. This grace that has appeared instructs us. We are instructed by the fact of grace. We're instructed by the truths of grace to live a saved life. What do I mean by that? Well, simply this. How can I not live for the Lord Jesus Christ when I live with an awareness of what He did for me on the cross? Love so amazing and so divine, the hymn writer would put it, demands my soul, my life, my all. Realizing the price that Jesus paid for me and for my forgiveness, when I look at the cross, I see how terrible my sin was and is. And I see the greatness of the love of God. Am I not motivated by the facts of grace to be what God would have me to be? I've been bought with a price, and that price was the shed blood and the very life of Jesus. As Paul was writing the church at Corinth, he says that they were to present themselves to the Lord, and that they were to do so understanding that their body is the temple of God. And he says, you glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's, because you were bought with a price. And so he's telling them, look at the price that God paid for your salvation. Look at the price that God paid for your soul. And as a result of being aware of the price that God paid, then you give Him what He bought. You give Him your life, your all. You give yourself unreservedly unto the Lord. And so the facts of the grace of God greatly motivate us to live a saved life. But on the facts of the grace of God, but the experiential power of the grace of God that has appeared, that grace of God that works in us as those who have received it, teaches us how we are to live. That's what the Bible is talking about when the Bible talks about our being born again. We are recipients of a spiritual birth by faith in the Lord Jesus. And we're not what we used to be. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature, a new creation. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. We are different because the Lord has saved us. The Bible says that it's not by works of righteousness in the very next chapter, in Titus chapter 3, verse 5. It's not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to His mercy, He has saved us by the washing of what? Regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Spirit. And so our soul is regenerated. We're made new. There's that renewing work that God does within us by His Spirit. And so our life is changed. We're transformed. We are made different by the power of the grace of God. So I am taught by the facts of grace to live a safe life. Just knowing what Jesus has done for me and knowing why He did it drives me, it teaches me to live a saved life. And then this grace of God that has appeared, that has been received internally into my heart and soul, is an internal force for God that produces a saved life. I'm trained outwardly and inwardly. I'm trained by facts and I'm trained by grace experience to live a saved life. There is, in this training, this instructing that we receive by grace, there is negative instruction and there is positive instruction. So we're going to break down verse 12 by looking at those two categories. Instructed by the grace of God to live a saved life. We're instructed, first of all, negatively. There's the negative instruction that's given to us. In verse 12, instructing us to deny. There's the negative instruction. That which we reject. That which we deny. Our Nehemiah is the Greek word. And it's a strong word of rejection. So it's a very strong word of disavowing, abnegating something. As a matter of fact, it's found in this same book in Titus chapter 1 and verse 16 where it talks about those who would by their words, they would claim to be God's people. They would profess God with their words. They profess to know God, but they deny Him in their work. Their life conflicts with and rejects their testimony. Their lifestyle is in conflict with their testimony that they know God. They say they know God. They claim that they know God. But if you watch their life, it conflicts with that. That's the way it's used in Titus chapter 1, verse 16. That word is also found, it's found in many places in the Bible. And it's translated often with the word deny. It's found in the book of Acts chapter 3, verse 13, where the apostle Peter is talking about those who rejected Jesus and called for His crucifixion. They denied Him before Pontius Pilate, the Bible says in Acts 3, verse 13, as they cried out for Him to be crucified. And so Paul is telling Titus, that's what the grace of God does within us. It strongly rejects that which is wrong. There is that compelling by the facts of God's grace and by the experience of God's grace, there's that compelling within us to reject those things that God would say we are to reject. That abstaining from things and turning from things and being in conflict with those things that are wrong. Romans chapter 6, verses 11 through verse 13, the Bible says that we are to consider ourselves to be dead to sin. If you'll remember the context there, in Romans chapter 6, verses 1 and following, Paul speaks about how baptism pictures our salvation experience, how that we are baptized with Christ in his death, and we are raised with him to walk in a brand new way of living. The Bible also says in Galatians chapter 2 and verse 20 that we are crucified with Christ. Paul said, I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. And so there is this death to sin, death to our lostness, death to our old ways of living. And so Paul, as he further developed that thought in Romans 6, says, so you consider yourselves dead to sin. You just live like that. And when temptation is before you, you say, no, I'm not going to do that. I'm dead to that. I'm dead. I'm not going to live that way. I'm dead to that. There's the power of the cross that's operative in my life. And I don't have to give in to that. I don't have to yield to that. I live a crucified life. So consider yourself dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. We've been raised with Jesus, and we live this newness of life. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body. Don't let it govern you. Do not let sin reign in your mortal body, that you should obey and bless thereof. But yield yourself to God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members, your bodies, and the components of your life as instruments of righteousness unto God. And so there is to be a strong rejection of sin and all those things that are wrong. Well, he identifies this sin that we are to deny with a couple of terms here in our text. He says, to deny godlessness. The King James and the New King James uses that word ungodliness. To deny godlessness or ungodliness. The term speaks of a lack of piety, reverence toward God. The idea is that this lifestyle of godlessness where there is no true worship of God and there is a living void of the fear of God, that's not to be among us as God's people. Instead, we're to be those who would worship the Lord, and we are to reverence the Lord, we are to fear the Lord, we are to live with a consciousness of God's presence with us and our accountability unto Him. So Paul says we reject godlessness, living a life that is born of all of God and the praise of God and rejoicing in the Lord and consecrating our lives unto the Lord. Living a life in which we are yielded unto Him. That's the life that we're to be living. So we reject godlessness. And then he says worldly loves. Those passionate desires that are created and sustained and promoted by sinful humanity. The lust of this world that characterized spiritual lostness is not to be the way that we live. These would be passions for power and prominence and pleasures that would be contrary to the will of the heart of God and be in conflict with the holiness of God. The Bible says in 1 John chapter 2, verses 15 and following, love not the world. That's not talking about rivers and streams and mountains and sky and all of that, but it's the system of philosophies and values that so conflict with God and the heart of God. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life, they are not of the Father, but they are of the world, and the world passes away. And the lust thereof, but he that does the will of God abides forever. In 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 2, the Bible there speaks about how Christ died for us so that as long as we live in our earthly life here in this world, as long as we live in these human bodies, that we, quote, listen to this, quote, no longer live, no longer for human desires, but for God's will. No longer living according to the desires that would be promoted by lost society. The masses of lost humanity, we don't live according to their lust, according to their passions. Our heart is what? It's fixed upon the kingdom of God. We're to be seeking first the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God and His righteousness. That's to me the lust of the passions of our life. Godly passions, godly desires. Those are to be the desires that we demonstrate. Looking down in verse 14, you notice there the Bible says that He gave Himself, Jesus gave Himself for us to do what? To redeem us from all the laws, all lawlessness. He gave Himself for us on the cross to save us from all of this. And so it's not to be our focus. It's not to be our lifestyle. It's not to be characteristic of us because God has saved us out of it. Then there's the positive instruction. See, after talking about what the grace of God has instructed us to deny, then He tells us what the grace of God instructs us to embrace. He says to live in a sensible, righteous, and godly way in the present age. And so He tells us to live sensibly. The idea means that with a sound mind, temperately. The one translation I looked at uses the word self-control there. With sound mind, temperately, and discreetly. Living a life rejecting Christ and rejecting the Lordship of Jesus. Not living under the Lordship of Jesus is senseless living and is a life of futility. Ephesians chapter 4 verse 17 says that lost people conduct their lives, quote, in the futility of their mind. They live out their life with futile thoughts, worthless thoughts in the futility of their minds. Well, since the Lord has saved us out of spiritual lostness, what do we have to have? We have to have a new way of thinking, right? We have to have a new mind. And if I'm going to live soberly, as the King James would put it, or with good sense, in a sensible fashion, then my mind has to be changed. And how does my mind get changed? Well, the Bible tells me that I am to have my mind transformed. My life has been transformed, Romans chapter 12, verse 2, by the renewing of my mind. Colossians 3:16 tells me that I am to let the word of Christ dwell in me richly. I am to let the word of the Lord fill my heart and my soul and my mind so that I can think correctly. Do you understand lost people don't think correctly? And when you're not thinking correctly, you don't live correctly. So we're to live sensibly according to the will of God. And then He says, righteously. We live in a sensible and righteous fashion. The word means equitably, justly, living according to what is right. Think of that word, righteous. Look at those first five letters of that word righteous. How do you spell righteous? R-I-G-H-T. Those first five letters is right. And that's the basis of righteousness. What is righteous living? It's just living like you ought to. It's correct living. It's right living. And so that implies that there is a right way to live. Where do we find that right way to live? Right here. Here's how we find the right way to live. We live by the Bible. We live by the teachings of Scripture. We live by what thus says the Lord. We live in obedience unto Him. Have you ever tried playing a game with someone who is just a very poor loser? And so they just change the rules all the time while you're playing? I've watched children do that. I've watched children 60, 70 years old do that. But I've watched little children do that. You know, just changing the rules constantly. And it's so frustrating, you know, when you're engaged in that. But I've watched kids do that. I know you have to. You know, one person play, and they, no, that's not what we're going to do. Here's the way we're going to do it. Here's how we're going to do it. And there's that constant changing of the rules. Mankind lives as though we have the right to constantly change the rules, and we don't. God's given us the rules for life. God's given us what is correct. God tells us how we are to live. then godly. Godly. We live in a sensible, righteous, and a godly way. That's piously. The idea is worshipfully and obediently and in a manner that reflects the very character of God. People ought to watch you and people ought to watch me and know we belong to the Lord. We're God's people. There ought to be a difference in the way that we live our life. People ought to be able to see that difference and say, you know, when I look at this individual and look at that individual, they remind me of Jesus. That's the way we ought to live. Where we're demonstrating the very character of Christ. And then notice he says that we do this in this present age. In the present age, the word age there is a word that's also translated in different places. The world, in this present world. Trench defines that word as, listen to this, the floating mass of thoughts. I've never thought about thoughts floating, but I think that's a good description. The floating mass of thoughts, opinions, maxims, speculations, hopes, impulses, aims, and aspirations. And so we're surrounded by a plethora of sin that finds its expressions in myriads of ways, but yet in the context of evil, all around about us, the waters of wickedness and sin and transgression that surround us in the midst of all of that, my dear friend, you can live a saved life. And I can live a saved life. We can't say, well, our environment is so wicked and so we just can't do it. No. In this present world, this is how you live. We don't get an out because we've got bad neighbors. Right? We can't blame it on the family pet. We live a godly life regardless of what our environment is. And it doesn't matter how wicked things are around about us. God's people are called to live a saved life. The grace of God instructs us to live a saved life. I thank God for the soul-saving and life-changing power of Jesus Christ. Amen? Thank God for the soul-saving, life-changing power of the grace of God in the Lord Jesus. When you think about, when you consider the facts of the grace of God, it ought to compel you to live a saved life. Just the facts ought to compel you. And when you couple the facts of grace with what goes on in your heart and soul, because you said yes to Jesus, there is the power of the grace of God that is operative within you and within me. And if it's not there, you need to really check your salvation experience. There ought to be an inner drive within you, calling you and compelling you to live a sensible, godly, and righteous life that rejects sin and ungodliness and lives for the honor and the glory of our Lord and Savior. Between the moment of my salvation, March the 26th, 1977, and until the day of my last breath here in this world, I will live a saved life. And if you know Jesus, you're living a saved life. Say, Pastor, I'm not living saved. Why are you saved? Have you ever repented of your sin and called upon Christ to save your soul? If not, oh, how I would beg you today, let this be the day of your salvation. Lord, I know I'm a sinner. I know you died for me on the cross. I know they buried you in the tomb. I know that you came back to life the third day. And you are Lord, and I confess you as my Savior and my Lord. Oh, I would urge you this morning to make that your prayer. And we're going to give you the opportunity to respond. and to share with me or with Dr. Collier this morning that today is the day of your salvation. And has one who says, yes, I know I'm saved. I know I'm saved, but I've allowed myself to be conformed to this world and I'm not living a saved life the way God would have me to. I'm glad to tell you this morning, the Bible says that if we will confess our sin, He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sin and to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. You say, Pastor, do you believe that God's a God of a second chance? Yeah, and a third, and a fourth, and a fifth, and a sixth, and a seventh, and a millionth, and a 10 millionth, and a 500 million, whatever that might be. I tell you, God will meet any repentant sinner with His grace and His forgiveness. And we would urge you this morning to come to the Lord. Walk out of this building living the life God has called you to. Would you do that? Let's stand together and bow in prayer.